We love you, Cheryl. We love you.
So that, I think that was my one, the one big thing that I came out from that experience was that it was really very positive. They're actually there to help us. They give us great suggestions. I got some fabulous suggestions of things that I would never have thought about. But I think the thing that really struck me was that I just didn't feel like a graduate student. I felt like I was a co-researcher. We were all just sitting there talking, and they were saying things, and I was saying things. And it was really very, very, it just kind of gave this experience the spirit of what research is all about and why we do it. And so it was really great. The other things I learned was, it's in my particular thesis, my thesis is very exploratory, it's not explanatory, but it was interesting that I was using a lot of explanatory language. So it's really important that that we when you're using words, you be careful about the words you use. Like I used factor a lot. Dr. Williams would say, well, what do you mean? Is this going to be a factor analysis? Are we doing some regressional thing going on here? So words convey certain things to them. And so I didn't really understand that. It really came out. And as I was looking through what I had written, it did sound very much like it was going to be a quantitative study, not a qualitative study. So you want to be careful, I guess, of that. The other thing was when I was doing my sampling, I talked about what kind of sampling I was going to use, what strategy or technique I was using, but I didn't really provide a rationale for it. So it's important to make sure that you present some rationale for your sample. For mine's an intensity sample. My rationale is that I want to find the most dramatic cases that I possibly can find, even if it's only 3 or 4, because the quantity is not more as important as the quality for this particular study. So. My criteria for trustworthiness, because I'm doing a qualitative study, I'm not doing reliability, validity, I'm not doing quantitative words, those are quantitative words. So I just used Link and Gubas, and I put them at the end of my methodology section. Dr. Williams said it made more sense to put it at the end of your analysis, data analysis, because your data analysis has a lot to do with your criteria as well. It affects it. So that was kind of a good suggestion. The other were just interviews. Is anybody doing qualitative studies here at all? Yeah, we're all doing qualitative studies. In my qualitative study, it's really important, and I thought I had worded my questions because I piloted them before to refine them, that my questions were, I thought that I was really getting to the kind of questions that people would actually tell me their stories, not give me an interpretation of their experience, but actually tell me their experience. So in this thing, I just said, ask questions so you can see people in action. You want to be very careful about that. You want to tell them, you want them to tell you their story, not their interpretation of their story, but their story. So the kind of questions you ask, like, I'm just trying to give examples here that they ask me. For instance, you would say things like, tell me the first time you remember this. Instead of just saying, describe this. You're pinpointing, because some of them may not even understand or remember their experiences, depending upon how far away they are from it. For instance, mine, it's been 2 years. So they might not even remember their first time that they remember hating math, or the first time they remember actually liking it. And so you want to kind of get down and drill down into those. Dr. Graham mentioned that you might, in an interview, might want to do just broad themes, like why did they hate it, and have some maybe questions underneath it. But he said sometimes it's better to have themes and then have questions, but the questions don't restrict you. So you might want to start being more thematic in your interviews. So for instance, for me, the 3 themes are hate, why do they hate it? The other one is change, what happened when they changed? And thirdly is, how do they end up loving it? What's the nature of that? What does that mean? What does that look like? And you want to have them describe that. So anyway, I think those were really the main things in my prospectus. But it's nothing to be scared of, because they really aren't going to tear you apart and beat you up, which I thought would happen, but it didn't. It was really very collaborative. And like I said, they really treated me like I was a researcher and not a grad student. And that's how I felt when I was talking to myself. There's my experience. And I passed. I'm so excited.
Yes. Thank you.
one-on-one?
For now. I think we're having everybody just do a little bit quick presentation, then everyone will be available to answer questions.
So it's my turn?
I think so.
Well.
Should we start asking you questions?
Well, everything I have to tell you is already on the website. You're all familiar with the website.
Which is exactly why we asked you to come, so that you could point it out and show us exactly where to find it and where it is.
Well, if you looked at the website, I wouldn't waste my time being here. None of us are wasting our time, so that's all right. I don't know how to do this with my back to you. I see better without my glasses. Well, what you want to do is you want to come under program. By the way, I hate this website interface. It's supposed to change tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
It's not my fault. I don't take any responsibility for the old one. What do you do? If you go under program, how many have the HD program? Most of them. Well, those are the HD. If you go over here to this, there are steps for completing a PhD program, PhD requirements, and requirements for each one of these projects. We go to the steps page. For those of you who have a computer, you might want to do that. We're supposed to be talking about perspectives, right? First, you have to get your committee, which he talks about. There's the link here for a dissertation. Here it talks about preparing your perspectives.
So in case everyone didn't catch that, all the information on the prospectus is underneath the dissertation page. So if you're looking for a prospectus on its own, it's under the dissertation.
Right, it's also under the projects. You can go to the project page.
Great.
You can read that on your own, but let me suggest, I think it should say, one of the things that we would start out with what I call a mini prospectus. Anybody done a mini prospectus?
Sort of. I did one page summary of my study. I shot it around as I was not emphasized.
What's the advantage of a mini prospectus?
Well, you don't have to. You don't have to go to the work of the full prospectus until you get some feedback from people and also solidify who's going to be on your committee and so on and so forth. And then you can dig in. That's one of the things. Plus, it forces you to boil it down to where you're seeing, is this a reasonable problem? If you think it's reasonable enough, you're probably not down far. You've got to keep going.
Right. And I highly recommend many perspectives. You're probably talking about 1 to 5 pages. If you've got 10 pages, it's probably way too much. What you want to do is do the minimum amount of work so that you don't waste your time. You can get feedback. Usually, if you go to a faculty member and say, this is what I have in mind, first thing they're going to say is write it down so I can review it. And if you write it down anywhere from 3 to 5 pages, then that's enough to give them an idea. Now, the most likely thing they're going to say when you get it back is elaborate on this. tell me more about that, tell me more about this. But they might tell you, this is in the tank. Start over, get a new idea, let's do some brainstorming. Any other questions about the mini perspectives? Now, what do you want to include in the mini perspectives? You want to include why you're interested in the project, whatever it is. How you want to approach the project. What kind of results you want to find out. It's kind of a summary of the full perspectives in as few pages as you can get. Andy, what would you like to say on the mini perspectives?
Question. I think that a prospectus can be summed up in a paragraph or less. And I want to see the distilled, what's the point, what's the question, what's the objective?
Mm-hmm. One of the things that Clint Rogers was going to be here, and I'm not sure what came up, but he's not here. He had mentioned to one of our classes that he started with literally three sentences and passed that around to his whole committee, and then went to a page and passed that around to his whole committee, and then went to three or four pages and passed that around to his whole committee, and that by the time it was time to defend the prospectus, there were virtually no changes that he had to make because it had been approved all along the way.
Right. Any students feel like faculty are intimidated and they're being asked to do or something like that? But the more iterations you can have, the better off you can be.
And they may even be nasty to you, but it's better to get them to be nasty to you
what you've spent 10 hours instead of
110. Then you get to the defense, yeah. and then they say, this is a good gun, what are you thinking? Yeah. So
use your
that, I mean, I'm not saying anybody was mean to me or anything like that so far.
Now, if you go to this website, there is a
perspectives
outline. There's an outline for presentations, an outline for development projects, there's an outline for research projects, an outline for evaluation projects. You have a question? One of the things that you might do is you might think, am I wasting my time on my perspectives? Why don't I just get on with it? Of course, it's possible for you to come in and hand your dissertation to your committee and say, love it. With no perspective, it's possible to do that. But if you do that, you may have to spend another semester. Or you may have to start over. So the prospectus, if your committee signs your prospectus document, it becomes a contract. And so it's unfair from my point of view for the committee to come back later and say, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? You should have done this. You should have done that. So it's a protection to you. The other thing is if you consider your prospectus as the first three chapters of your dissertation and they approve it, and you've already got three chapters of your dissertation done. Well, we're going to have members of the panel. Who else wants to?
You're probably wondering why I've called you all here today.
Can't hold there because we're recording.
Oh.
Because there are half a dozen people who can't be here who really want to be here. Okay.
All right. Now, we're talking about prospectuses for projects, for theses and dissertations, all of those, all of the above. I think that an important place to begin in a prospectus is keeping in mind why you're doing it. What's the point of doing a project or a thesis or a dissertation? What would you say to you?
To expand the knowledge because you're curious about something.
To add to knowledge in some way.
Yeah.
What do you think, Randy?
For the prospectus?
No.
Or for the...
Why are we doing a thesis or a dissertation?
graduated.
That's one reason. Well, I think you said it well in the other session that we had on this, was that you're demonstrating your ability to organize and carry out an inquiry that is important and interesting and that concludes something of value to others.
Yeah, Linda?
Basically, what he's trying to say, what he's saying with very successful actually, is that we need to, it gives us a chance to try doing some research and show them what we can do.
That's right. And the research can't be just what I did for my, with my summer, or it can't be, I know we already know this, but I did this research. And so it just demonstrates again what we already know. There's a reason for it. One of the things, now, here's the interesting thing, and I was surprised by this when I came into the academic world, because we have this vision that we're doing science. And one of the things that we have to understand is that we're not necessarily doing science. We can create knowledge through other ways. Humans create knowledge through other means. I won't go into it in detail now, because I think several of you have heard me talk about this in classes or presentations. This is a paper called Explore, Explain, Design. And it describes three major ways that humans create new knowledge. Briefly, one of them is scientific, random trials, empirical research. One of them is through designing something and learning, not just designing something and saying, oh, I got this great idea last night, I'm going to go develop it right now. But somehow connecting that design to a theory of design, or a theory about how things can or should be designed. And then being able to say at the end, here's what I learned not only about this product, but about this theory. The third kind of research is what's called in here explore. It means natural history. I'm reading a book now. If you want a really good read over the Christmas holidays, find a book that's called Humboldt's Cosmos. Humboldt. Von Humboldt was one of the great natural historians. He was one of the first people to explore the north end of South America in detail. And the story is a great adventure read, but it's also a description of natural history and how you do it. Natural history is finding what's out there in the world. Finding it, asking questions, seeing it for the first time, seeing it new. Okay, so I'll leave copies of this for anybody who doesn't already have a copy of it. But the first thing that you should do is try to figure out what kind of an activity you're carrying out. Are you going to do natural history? Are you going to do a design study? Are you going to do empirical research? Then the second thing, it seems to me, that you want to keep in mind is, why am I doing it? We're used to thinking of science as producing the knowledge for us. We're used to depending on knowledge from science. One of the things that really surprised me once I came into the academic world is how uncertain knowledge is. We don't know all the things that we think we know. We don't know all the things that the scientists tell us that they know. I'm willing to say that most of what we know as, most of our knowledge is wrong. Okay? Now, so what is the exercise of science? It is not proving something, and what is the exercise of science, or of design studies, or of natural history? It's making an effective argument. It's figuring out what it is that you're trying to say, and then, like a very good lawyer, framing an argument and presenting evidence that creates the most airtight case that you possibly can create. Okay? Now, before school started, I gave a talk at the opening conference for some people. I made a transcript of what I said there. Basically, and I'll leave these for people who don't have a copy of the record. I put some out at the beginning of the semester on the table out there in the foyer. and some people got copies of it. But let me finish the idea this way. Whether it's natural history, design studies, or scientific studies, there is a rhetoric. Now, rhetoric, what's a rhetoric? What's rhetoric? You know what rhetoric is. It's
articulate.
It's the way of being convincing. Whether in speaking or writing. What were you saying, Sarah Jo?
It's a language of persuasion.
It's the way to persuade. Scientists get their ideas accepted, not because they have these undeniable proofs. They get their ideas accepted because they are persuasive in their argumentation.
Well, rhetoric's not just scientific, right? I mean, there's rhetoric for religion, there's rhetoric for...
rhetoric is persuasion.
Yeah.
You were just right. Okay, for instance, when Einstein came up with the theory of relativity, the special theory, as a matter of fact, he was interpreting data which was there. He was reinterpreting data, but he was also inventing a lot. And there wasn't proof of his theory for years and years, although it was generally accepted. When did we finally get the lensing effect, the gravitational lensing effect? It was like 40 years after he propounded the theory. Isaac Newton, the same way, with his laws of motion and the laws of light. He simply stated them and waited for 20, 30 years for the guard to change that had opposed his ideas. And then they became persuasive. Why? Because he was the last person standing. That's the same thing happened, by the way, with quantum theory. When it was first proposed, even the person who proposed the theory thought, this cannot possibly be true. And Einstein just went crazy. He thought it was a terrible theory, but it has stood the test of time. And at the time, it was accepted because the argument made for it was persuasive. Okay. Now, that sounds like a terrible thing to be encouraging people to do. But here's how it comes into play when you're designing a prospectus. You have to figure out what it is that you're going to know that you didn't know before. And figure out how you're going to find that thing out. Figure out what evidence you're going to need to make the strong argument. Figure out what kinds of treatments that's going to require. Figure out what kinds of data collection that's going to require. But figure out what your argument might be. And then be prepared when you're writing your dissertation not just to go through a high school exercise, but to actually make the argument seriously. And that means the literature review is not just a formality. That means that the literature review has grounded you well enough so that you can make a convincing argument with the people who did the research and the literature that you're reading. You need to become, for just a brief moment, the world's expert in whatever it is that you're writing. Okay? So that's my advice.
For just a brief moment, though.
For just that moment. 15 minutes of fame. And then something else lines up. So, questions? That's pretty much all I needed to say. Okay.
I have a point. Okay. I've kind of had I'm close to finishing my dissertation, and I've had experience with the project prospectus, the master's thesis prospectus, and now the dissertation prospectus. And they're all kind of similar, but different flavors to those experiences. An example of that is, well, let me ask, how many PhD students?
Okay,
how many master's students? Okay. The master's thesis is not the same as a dissertation in the sense that there's heavier weight placed on a dissertation in the sense that it has to be accepted as new knowledge to the community, and therefore there's some more rigor involved in that. And there's different types of master's thesis you can do, not just a research project. So there is a difference between the two things. And there's a different number of people on the committee. So for master's thesis, there's 3, and on the PhD, there's 5. That dynamic alone makes things different.
Mm-hmm.
It just is the nature of human beings. It would be easier to get 3 people to together and to talk to 3 people on a continuing basis, and then to have them in the bomb place one time to agree to something than 5. I mean, that's just natural. So there are differences involved in both of those types. And what what I've experienced is I've learned by my mistakes. So now that I've made all my mistakes, I can pass along, and it's like, I think that to some extent academics or being graduate is a little bit like callings we have in the church, that the moment you get it right is about the time you get released. And so you get it right just at the end, and they wish you'd have known a bunch of stuff. So here's some of the things I wish I would have known right at the beginning. So especially for a dissertation, well, they're kind of the same thing, but this idea of regularly having contact with your committee from the beginning is a really good idea. But I didn't realize we were even allowed to do. I thought we were being told that you work mostly with your chair. But let me go back one step. Who doesn't have a committee form? Who's at that stage? Committees, going back one step, but choosing a chair and choosing a committee, that these are important things in graduate studies. So somewhere along the line, you're going to choose some topic, hopefully, that you're enthusiastic about, and you're going to find your way to matching that topic with a faculty member who is also interested to some degree. I made the mistake, and there are a lot of things I didn't know. I come from a business background before I came back to school, and it's a totally different world from the business world to the academic world, and both have pluses and positive and negative things about the situations. And one of the things I found out quite quickly is I couldn't come in to say, I'm interested in studying the education of dinosaurs or something, something I was interested in. And I was just kind of not knowing anything, thinking, well, some people think that's a kind of good idea and say, great, go for it, we'll help you with that. That's not how it is. And that's not a good or bad thing, it's just not how it is. How it is you need to find somebody who has some tie to the interest that you have and who is willing to develop that particular topic that you're interested in. It doesn't have to be the whole committee, but certainly your chair will be somebody who is jointly interested or willing to help with that particular thing. So that was something that took me a while to figure out, coming into the academic arena. So once you figure that out, and then picking a committee is an interesting task. Just like I said, 3 in 5 people would have to agree together to what you're doing. It's an important thing to do, to choose your committee. You don't want to just randomly pick people. The best thing is to pick people who are interested, if you can, to find interest in the same topic. And, or at least to some degree, because you might not be able to find a group that all have interest in that particular thing. You might not. So just as close as you can to find people that are interested in both your topic and also the methodology, the style of research you would like to do.
And to some extent, there's a personal compatibility too.
Yeah.
Like if you have a committee chair that, frankly, you rub them the wrong way, it's not going to go very well.
Yeah. And if you have a chair that you kind of butt heads with all the time, then you might get through, eventually get your PhD, but who do you think your prospective employers are going to ask about you? Your chair, predominantly the person you've worked with. And if you're not willing to put your chair on your resume, on your curriculum vitae, some questions might be asked about that. So I've been told. So I'm learning these things, but that's not really a problem for me. I was going great. Like, we have great people in the department who are willing to help an awful lot.
The other thing, too, is that you might want to make sure you find a faculty member who knows the literature in your area, because some faculty members might not take you on because they would have to go in and learn a whole new, and they don't have time to do that.
Yeah.
So you probably want to find somebody who's aware of the literature and the methods and the research style in that particular. It would make it a lot easier for you because they can advise you better.
The way I learned this, I went to meet with a faculty member before I had really... I kept changing my ideas. I came into the department thinking I had some ideas, and then I changed them about 50 times, and then back up my original ideas. Should have just stayed there in the first place. But I went to talk about a certain set of ideas with a certain faculty member, and I said, I've got these ideas about this, that, and the other, and the faculty member says, yeah, I'm not interested in that. You should maybe talk to X, Y, and Z. It kind of floored me. I just had nowhere to go with that. But that was a learning experience for me to help me understand the academic environment. He wasn't saying, hey, I don't like your ideas.
Or I don't like you.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
So So we don't see faculty members as necessarily going to agree with you all the time and just do whatever you want to do, but they're not enemies either. But it isn't, how do I say it? I think it's a really good thing about academia that I didn't like at the beginning and now do. It takes a while to kind of get understand its purpose. But in an academic environment, the peers who are reviewing things that you do, they have a purpose. And one of the purposes is to make sure whatever comes out is good, helpful, good for you, good for the community, and is solid research. So that means that they're not going to disagree, they're not going to agree with you if it's not good research. They have a purpose, and kind of describe them as like term warm personal enemy, which means that they might say I like you, but your tie stinks. You know, they're really good people in our department as well. And this is the great thing about being at BYU, particularly, is we've got good Christian people also who are good academics, which is wonderful.
I just have a question about committees. Do you have to pick faculty members for a committee? Could they be adjunct faculty? Could they be emeritus faculty? Like, what kind of faculty do you have?
Yes, you can. And for example, you can also pick, I don't know what the rule is, but the PhDs who work in CTL can be on a committee.
They have to be graduate, they have to teach a graduate class. So they have to be graduate faculty, or you have to take it to the dean's office and get approval.
You could also have faculty for other departments that will be co-chairs with yours. So if, for instance, the faculty member in your department doesn't have the expertise that you want, but somebody else on faculty on the campus does, they can come in and be a part of a co-chair kind of
thing. Let me tell you my other mistake that I did. That's a really good question. I had this really grand idea about what I was going to do, and I was going to bring in information. I was really interested in neuroscience. I took some graduate classes in neuroscience. And also developmental biology, and had a really good friend who was a faculty member there. So I thought, I'm going to have a faculty member for neuroscience, for biology, and some from our department. I'm going to bring all these different facets to my committee. You must have a really good reason if you want to do that. I would not recommend doing that. And the reason is number one, it's already hard enough to get people together in one department. You start getting diverse faculty from different departments. Getting together is going to be one thing, but then what I've noticed is the methodologies and styles of research are different for different departments. And so I was going to my neuroscience guy, saying I want to be on my committee, and I'm doing educational research, but I want to bring in elements and research in neuroscience to back it up. But that faculty member, I couldn't see that. When I talked to him, he just kept saying, well, it has to be this style of research. And he was trying to tell me it has to be scientific neuroscience research. It's not what I want. I wasn't interested in that. I wanted a representative of that domain to help me make sure my facts are straight about neuroscience. That's all I was interested in. So I ended up, that was just a bad idea. So if you want to mix departments, make sure you really understand your reasons for doing it, have really good reasons for doing it. This is what I think. So the committee side of it's really important, and then once you start, once you've got an idea that you'd like to work on, and you and your chair are both happy with it, and you kind of understand your theoretical framework approach, then I've learned that it's a good time to be talking to all of your committee that you've chosen regularly. So what I did for my first dissertation defense is I worked a lot with my chair. And then 2 weeks before the defense, or 10 days before the defense, sent it to my committee, and there were just tons of questions in my dissertation defense. But at the time, I must admit, I didn't appreciate the experience at the time, because I had an agenda. I wanted to get things done, and I had timelines and things, and I was focused on that. But my committee were focused on, is this good? Is this good research? Does it make sense? Can we understand it? Does it flow? Does your biases and your the background match your theoretical approach, and the questions you're asking, are they answered well by this approach, and all those kind of questions to make sure it's a succinct research study that well answers the question, a good question that's well answered, and it's a tight study. And that's what the committee's responsibility is, to make sure it happens. So it's a wonderful thing that is really good, but I didn't like it at the time because I wasn't getting my timeline fulfilled. After that, I realized that it was a great thing because I would eventually have a much better product. I would say, especially in dissertation, forget timelines. If you've got a timeline and you where you want to make it, that's kind of somewhat defeating the purpose of PhD. PhD is more about the research than it should be about, I want to get a certificate and can get moving. So concentrate on that. And then you're allowed to meet with all members of your committee. I didn't realize that. I didn't want to bug them. I thought this is a lot. So a lot of prospectuses are going to be, so my master's prospectus was probably 20, 30 pages long, but my dissertation prospectus is 60 pages long, which isn't huge for research, but that's a lot of pages to read if you're reading it, kind of reviewing on a regular basis. Mike, how big was your prospectus? Admit to me.
95.
That's how big my whole master's thesis was. So, I mean, these prospectuses can get pretty intense.
Now I have to make it shorter.
So here's another thing to think about, is do you think that five members of the committee can regularly read 100 pages with everything else that they've got going? There are things to think about that I didn't really think about in my first rounds. So, when you think you're at a point where you've got a good process going for your prospectus, I certainly would recommend individually meeting each member of your committee. They might not be able to read it all the time, but they might. My experience is that different members will have different focus that they're interested in your research design. Some might be really interested in the analysis process. Some might be interested specifically in your theoretical approach and your questions, and what are you really trying to answer. And altogether, that makes a really good questioning for you to make sure that it's a good prospectus. So meet with each one of them as you're developing it, and that really assures by the time you get to defending, you really answered most questions. But also being reminded that I'm not sure that your member's going to fully read to a very intense degree until you're ready to defend. So you still might have things to resolve in your defense, but don't worry if you do, because that's a good thing, because that still makes it a better research study if you're doing it. And who's heard of horror stories from other universities about dissertations? I've heard tons, but I've not heard any from you. And so you're going to hit barriers at certain points, maybe. Those are good barriers. Those are learning experiences and the opportunity to improve whatever it is you're doing. So do remember that. The faculty's job isn't to just give you what you want and get you through the certificate. It's also to make to help you develop whatever you're doing to make sure it's good. Because it doesn't just represent you, it represents the department, it represents BYU, and in the academic community. So it has to be good. What else have I learned? Any questions while I'm thinking about anything else I've learned from this? Yes.
Can I comment on a few things you mentioned?
Yeah.
One thing that would help the faculty is if you use turn on tracking changes when you make changes from one version to the next. And give back to the faculty member the comments they made the first time. So if I make all kinds of red marks on your piece of paper, it would be very helpful if I got that piece of paper back. So I can just look at what you've done with my comments. So the parts I haven't commented on, I'm going to ignore. So I can review it in one-tenth of the time it would take otherwise. The other thing is, if I give you comments this week and I don't see it again for 6 months, I'm not going to remember anything I commented about. And so it's going to take longer for me to review it again. And I'll probably find all kinds of things I didn't find the first time. So it's to your benefit. You want the faculty to have quick turnarounds. To your benefit to have a reasonable turnaround. The other thing is, if you procrastinate the day of your attendance for 5 years, and then come to the faculty member and want them to review it in 5 days, you're not too sympathetic.
Another thing to remember is that in a defense, the faculty isn't going to be five faculty or three discussing with you. It's also three discussing with each other, or five discussing with each other about about the merits of your methodological, your, I can't say that word, your theoretical approach. And so there may be differences of opinion between faculty members with different backgrounds and ideas that have to be resolved. Again, another good experience to understand how the academic community works. And do remember this as well, that don't feel bad about having to change things or modify things, or sometimes when they're big, because academics, faculty have to do that for the rest of their career too. And I'm told often a lot harsher than it happens to graduate students. So that's just the way of the academic world, is peer reviewers helping maintain quality throughout research, which is a really, it's different to what I experienced in the business world. That's not how things work. But so it may take some transition, but it's a good thing. I find it a good thing. Thank you for that. What else? There's maybe some tips for actually getting started, because that's one of the problems, is how do you get started on a prospectus? What do you write? And so one of the things I learned to do is kind of bullet my the headings I'm going to have for different for chapter and subheadings before I actually start writing a lot of stuff, which gives me my flow. I'm going to talk about this, I'm going to talk about this, I'm going to talk about this, give my argument flow. So, who knows the elements of a prospectus? Does anybody know the elements? Okay, so you've got something like an abstract, an introduction of some kind, you're introducing the theme and the topic. You're going to have some your major questions that you're pointing out at that point, and then you're going to have some kind of literature review. And that's quite a long section. And that's where you really dive into research and what other people have said about the topic in some kind of logical flow, where you start at some point, set up the discussion, and then follow through quoting, citing other research and documents, where you're really setting up the backdrop and the background for whatever topic it is you're going to discuss. And then after that, you're going to explain your process. Your method section, which is going to talk about the actual methodology you're going to use, and then it's going to get into detail about the actual process you're going to go through to gather data, and then to analyze data, and then to present data. And one of the things I think I'm learning, especially with the PhD, is once you have your prospectus signed, it's you just have to do what you've signed. That's the agreement, the contract. Therefore, the more detail you get into what you will do in your study, the more likely you are to be able to pass it simpler at the end, to have your committee agree when it's finished. Because if you say, in good detail, in my analysis process, I'm going to take this data, I'm going to do this, I'm going to say this, I'm going to then do this with it, then that's what you have to do. And so that makes it's actually a really good process to simplify your final work, get the prospectus right. And it can be a heavy experience to get through to the end of that agreement, and the reason for that is because it's a contract. So the faculty have to make sure that your prospectus is right, because they're agreeing to what you do. So that's
my husband gave me some really good advice once, because he teaches here on campus, and he advises students. He said, for your lit review, you want to tell a story. You just don't want to cite, oh, this person did this, and this is what they did, this person did this, and this is what they did, because a lot of his students do that, they just list all the stuff. He said, you want to tell a compelling story, and use the literature that's been done, but...
And this is going to build your argument, literature review will build your argument for why it's important your research and what you're researching. Mm-hmm. It's the gap, it's providing the gap in knowledge by a research and literature, and then saying at some point, and therefore, here's the problem, here's the gap. Mm-hmm. And literature is set up and give them that sort of base of your argument.
This might apply more towards when you're doing discussion and findings, but I've seen it applies to your lit review as well. I mean, Ryan Mazzari told me that an academic paper is not a mystery novel. So when you get to that gap, people should be shaking their head. They should already make those, your research should read, your paper, your argument should read in such a way that everyone's going to come to those conclusions, or at least it makes sense. It's logical. shouldn't be surprised by now, this is the gap. They should be expecting you to say it.
Yeah. You were just confirming at that point, yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
For example, if you're doing a development project, your literature ought to inform the, how you're going to design and develop the instruction. And it ought to be obvious at the end of your literature, this is how it applies to what I'm doing. If it doesn't apply, then the question is, what is the third part?
Another bit of advice, I think that's come out of the mistakes I've made is, and I think this is just part of being a graduate student, we have classes on things like qualitative and quantitative research, but I come out of those classes knowing some general things going on, but not in detail. I didn't understand all those approaches in detail, and there's so many of them as well, for especially for qualitative, there's so many approaches. Where I recognize, again, and not until after my first defense, that there was so much more I really needed to know. And part of the experience of developing your perspectives will help you with that, but recognize that you're going to have to be able to describe your process well enough and cite well enough where your process comes from. And so you need to understand it. And so part of your perspective development is really understanding the methods you're going to use deep enough that you gain some expertise in those methods. But that's kind of a paradox because we're not experts yet. We're learning. But to some extent, you have to kind of show some expertise in your methods that you're using in your perspective.
Well, that's why you have a committee, because they do have expertise.
Yes. But not necessarily, because here's the trouble, is you may find a method you want to use is this exact thing, but it might be somewhat compatible with the research areas of the different faculty, but not exactly. So they might be able to sit down and say, yeah, it's this thing, and this is how you do it. I can tell you that's what happened to me. I found a qualitative approach called formative research, which is, it's not very complicated, but it's not one that is typically used. It's because I want to develop a theoretical model rather than answer some maybe typical questions. So it just depends. So you may have to become the expert in the thing, in the method you're using. I think also, the only thing I want to say is I think that we're very fortunate in this department to have people who work really hard with you. Faculty who will spend an awful lot of time working with you, and that's something we can be grateful for because that really is exceptionally helpful and we are really mentored well. And that time is not... Well, faculty are busy with doing all sorts of things, and some faculty have several people that are working for us as chairs, and that's a lot of time in strong. So, just something I think that I'm grateful for. It's really good here. Anything else?
Any questions?
It's really unusual for me.
And maybe just two more.
Please.
You're usually so unwilling to share your opinions, and
yes.
When you do, you succeed.
You're very.
You know.
One problem you're going to face is different faculty have different things they're doing. So sometimes you give them a document and it disappears. You never hear back from them because they've got an attack that's high to go through. One tactic is set up a meeting. So you give them a document and say, I'd like to meet with you to discuss it. When can we meet? And they might say, well, I'm going to South Africa. I won't be back for 3 weeks, so at least you know. But if they agree to the meeting, they will look a little bit foolish if they come to the meeting and they haven't had a chance to look at it. So setting up a meeting with an individual faculty member or with your whole committee is an extremely valuable tactic.
I think what I did too, at least this is just for my master's though, but I just had a standing meeting every week with my chair. And so it was just a way for me to keep, one, myself on track, but two, I knew that I had to report something every week to him, you know? And so I didn't want to come up and say, I've done nothing this week. And sometimes I did, I'd have to say, well, I just didn't do anything this week on this, but it really helped me a lot to keep me going. So that was a good thing.
And another thing you can do is don't go to the meeting and say, here's a document, tell me what you think about it. Because they don't want to sit there and read the document while you're willing to get them, so they send them the document ahead of time. Another thing is there's the APA bugaboo. And it's a serious bugaboo. So you might as well put it all in your prospectus, follow APA style, so you start getting in the practice of doing it. And there's a resource on the web to help you. Of course, there's also the manual to help you. But you won't graduate unless it matches APA style. So.
Maybe the process is worth describing as well, because you have to know that you've got a committee who's going to approve at some point whatever it is you're doing, but there's also the dean's office that also have to approve it. So you may have a committee that says, this is fine, we sign it off, but the dean's office might say, well, we don't like, there's bits we don't like, change it. So there's more than one point to this. And then, even when the dean's office have approved it, there is a process to go through to get your document in the electronic, whatever it's called, the electronic thing in the library. There is things you have to do to your document and a set of processes. So when you think you're done with the with your committee and the dean's office, you're not fully done. So if you're in a master's program and you think about timelines, that can be a lengthy process, because the dean's office aren't kind of at the beck and call. They have work to do. And so you get your committee to approve, it goes up to the dean's office. It may take a while, and then it comes back. You might have some changes. It goes back, and it may take a while. And then after they've approved it, then it takes a few weeks to get things through the electronic submission process. So there is a process involved.
Is there a fixed deadline? So if someone wanted to graduate in April, their dissertation needs to be done in January, something like that?
I found out something interesting recently about that. Number one, you have to, whichever semester you think you're going to graduate in, you have to have credits for either your master's thesis or your PhD, your dissertation. So you have to kind of try and time your actual finishing with actually having credit hours. But there is one, I'm trying to answer your question first. The question was the timing for when you do that.
Like if one's going to graduate in April, when does the dissertation have to be approved by your committee? Like when does the committee have to have signed off with all the other steps you just mentioned?
When you say graduate, do you mean
walk?
Yeah, to walk, you can do that whenever you like. I personally do not want to do that until I'm done. But you can have a few things left.
You could defend the day before April graduation, and you'd be able to walk, but the date on your diploma is not going to be till August. Because you have to have it to the library a month before you graduate, and then at that point, it's done. So from what I understand, you could, if you wanted to walk in April, you could defend and pass the day before, walk, but your diploma will read April and not, August, not April.
If you go to the graduate school office, they have a form that lists
the timelines, yeah.
I should tell you this as well. The secret. There is such thing as spring graduation that they won't tell you about, but they will do if you have a special need for it, because I did that. So you can actually go through, you can do it in June instead of April too.
But once you defend it successfully, it's not like the library is going to reject your thing. You're done at that point, even though there might still be some processes to get
correct. And that process includes changing your document into this very strict PDF document format. That's formatted so you can click on chapters, and so all of your headings, you can actually click on them and go to them in the PDF document. And that's not a trivial task. It depends. If you've used all the words, features from the beginning to do your document automatically in headings and things like that, then it's pretty easy.
I think, is it true in this department? I know that in other departments, you have to be registered for credits the semester you defend, but not the semester you necessarily graduate. For instance,
right.
I could defend in April, but not graduate till August, as long as I'm registered for classes this semester, I defend.
And you can do the opposite too. That's what I found out. In my case, as a full timer, I can't. I have this conflict between when I will physically finish and the credits I'm allowed to put in as a full timer. So I'm allowed to defend at the end of the summer term, and then just do nothing. I don't put my doctorate through the process until it kicks into the fall semester and just have some credits in that semester too, so you can do that either way. as I understand it. Because I did my master's thesis the other way, like you just said, Cheryl.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do it. It's either way.
By the way, if you're planning on graduating in April of 2009, you have to defend. You have your defense by March 6th, and it has to be scheduled. You have to schedule it by February 20th and apply for graduation by January 20th.
Right, that's not connected to walking. So no, you can walk without that process being fully.
Like sometimes I know that there are students that the wife and the wife and the husband are both. I'm trying to remember this. What was it? Oh yeah, I guess they were gonna graduate in August. One of the couples, one of the spouses was gonna graduate in August, but one was gonna graduate in April. They wanted to bring their families out, you know, at both times. So one of the spouses just walked a semester early. So the family was all there and blah, 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 so.
Let me ask this to the faculty so everybody can understand. Mm-hmm. I think what's important, even though for a job using your PhD, people generally care about whether you defended your dissertation. Is that correct? The technicalities of whether it's fully organized. Am I right that it's more about have you defended your dissertation?
They don't care whether you walk or not.
Yeah.
They care whether you have a diploma.
Oh, they care about the certificate.
Well, that you have actually
successfully defended, I guess.
Successfully defended is one thing, but also you have to finish your coursework here.
Right.
Yeah. And some of them will actually accept your ABD, which means all but dissertation.
Yeah.
But then you usually have to have a pretty good plan for finishing.
Super advice. I can potentially finish my coursework, like, next semester, but I haven't even started. So I might even get into trouble with that.
Well, the other thing is you can't start certain things until you finish certain things as well. Coursework's okay, but the projects, you have to finish your projects before you can start your dissertation. Master's thesis, how was that? I can't remember for master's. Are you master's or PhD?
Yes.
You start with, there's no prerequisite to start with.
Okay. But I'm saying, like, where they're going to make you take credits all the way through the other semester. Am I going to run out of credits? I can't count. Like, my course would be done. You know what I mean? I'm wondering if I should spread those classes out so that I have time to work on my thesis. Is that?
Well, your thesis, you have 6 credit hours.
Oh, okay. So you get.
So if you wanted to take 2 one semester and 4 another, you can do that.
But you can also take 2 more.
But you have to pay for 2 credit hours a semester you graduate.
Okay.
I think we're going to close up. If anybody has other questions, do you have some more?
Almost all your questions are answered on the web. So if you don't know how to find it, come and see me. I'll be happy to find it for you.
Excellent. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Great. And there's some treats here, so
if the answer's not there, tell me and we'll put it somewhere.